basically got to go to graduation here. I don't know if we'll make a career of that or not, but we were talking the same thing. Because he was doing this kind of general studies, trying to transfer to the app state, but he wasn't making any progress. We tell him to make a priority for him. It's just that he's plenty smart. He was getting very bright. He just lacked all the
Every day. You can talk to a bunch of pastors.
Congratulations. I'm glad to be back. My home state, I'm glad to be back.
This is going to be a religious theme talk today. I realize if I was dropped down to earth in a different place than Dunn, ugliest town in North Carolina, voted on by several travel magazines. Just looking at all the different religions, I might have been Buddhist. And so our blessing today is a Buddhist blessing.
I just realized I can't see it. So our Buddhist blessing, as we gather here today in friendship and community to learn, share, and reflect on the insights, experiences, and wisdom of others, we're reminded how blessed we are. In the current world around us, there are many who suffer and face grave challenges. We stand in solidarity with them in compassion and loving kindness. Anybody disagree with the Buddhist? And I'm not one to complain, but some of our greatest Christmas music was written by Jews.
Yeah.
White Christmas.
Yep.
Irving Berlin.
Yep.
Chestnuts roasting on the open fire, Mel Torme. I didn't realize he was Jewish until this morning. Let it snow, let it snow, let it snow, Sammy Cohen. It's the most wonderful time of the year. Ed Pola and George Weil. And a lot of these names, most of them were Russian Jews, and they changed their names when they got to the United States. Silver Bells. Santa Baby, one of my favorites. And all three songs here written by Johnny Marks, who was Jewish. Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer, Rocking Around the Christmas Tree, and A Holly Jolly Christmas.
Three of my favorites.
Walking in a Winter Wonderland. So, why in the hell do we sing the dreidel song? Is that more here?
No.
We got to straighten this out. Let's pick one of the better Jewish songs to sing our next holiday season. We got some guests here today. All the guests in there, whoever they will, stand up and introduce your guests.
Yes, sir.
Yep.
All right, I have two guests today. The first is Brian Anna, who may be familiar to some of you. His father has been in our Rotary Club for many years. And I said, please give him a hard time, but I got Brian here and he didn't. So, welcome, Brian. And then also today we have Ian Scott, who has just moved back to North Carolina from Beaufort, South Carolina, and he's joined our local Chamber of Commerce as the Vice President of Advocacy.
Cool, thank you.
Any other guests? Any visiting Rotarians? Oh, well, introduce yourself.
Tim Atkins, here from the Chapel Hill Rotary Club, Tuesday Night Club.
Yeah, really excited. Has anybody got anything important they want to talk about? It's good to have Mike Phillips here. Nobody has more miles on their car or more travel miles than Mike Phillips.
It's about rotation.
Yeah. All right, President Mike.
Wow, it sure is nice to see everybody here today. It's a full room today. Somebody must have heard we were having gumbo. You know? Great job on the food today, guys. So we're back here again. A couple quick things here. I've got Lorenzo, he's got a couple comments here. He's got need some help coming up for a lot of projects. We're gonna give Lorenzo the floor here.
Five basket.
Perfect. Five basket. For all of you who didn't think Carolina was going to win the other night, put some money in the basket.
Hey, Mike, thank you. So good afternoon, everybody. I'm here. I want to ask if some of you guys can think about helping with the need we have in our club. I need one or two club members to transport three high school students to the Ryla camp in Oxford, North Carolina. That's about an hour away from here. One transportation will take place on the morning of Friday, April 5th, and leaving Chapel Hill about 8 o'clock with these three high school kids. And then the next one will take place on April 7th, which is Sunday. Pick them up around noon up in Oxford and bring them back. So many of you folks are new. RYLA stands for the Rotary Youth Leadership Academy. This is one of the signature youth services that Rotary engages in worldwide. And it's held annually for our district at Camp Oak Hill. It's a leadership camp which is provided free of charge. These kids are given scholarships for approximately 130 select high school juniors from the Triangle, and we have nominated three, and they will be going. And it's a requirement of the program. It's a Rotary requirement that parents do not take them. They have to be taken by a member of the sponsoring club. So I had sent out an email, and I did get a number of responses, and I've acknowledged those, and I thank them. They were all from people who are long-established members who've been very active helping our club. And these are great people, but I wanted to just throw this out. Many of you are new or maybe haven't had a chance to participate in service yet, and this is a great opportunity to do that. So if you feel so inclined, please let me know. It's about 3 hours total on the morning of Friday, April 5th, and another will be 3 hours total on Sunday, the following Sunday, April 7th. Thank you.
Rotary program, we've been something the club has been working and doing for many, many years. Lorenzo's done a great job keeping it going. If you've got the time, please help us out with this. You know, it's an hour or two out of your life. You might learn something from hanging out with some young people every now and then. Before I bring up my next person with a special event here, a little tradition in the club, I'm thinking we're talking with UNC about having a Carolina baseball, a family event. I get this like a show of hands of people that would be interested. This would be a family event. Bring your kids. You know, they have that nice facility down first baseline. It's fun. So I'm talking with the ticket office about that, trying to get a handle on it. I'm gonna get my able people to send out an email on this. We'll have a sign up so I can go back to them and say, this, I'm thinking about doing it like on a Friday or Saturday. The Saturday is a day game most of the time. That might fit the parent's schedule better. I really want something that we can include everybody in. We haven't done that in a long time. I think that would be good for us and club. So we'll get coming up next week or so, we'll get that out. I'm looking to do that in April when the weather gets better so we can. And then we got a great schedule. Caroline's got a great home schedule this year. So it'll be fun. We'll have baseball night. We've done this before. Doctor, you ready?
Sure.
I'm going to bring up Liz with a special presentation. So come on up, Liz.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay.
Closer to the mic, Liz.
It was just there.
It was just there. It disappeared. There you go.
This is a story.
Usually we have a problem. It's technology. It's always hated.
Probably into the cable and kind of replay.
Well, thanks. So I have to wing it here.
Okay. Well, this is a story of Peggy and the Golden Goose. You'll remember that Peggy was awarded the Golden Goose before Christmas, but Peggy has not received the Golden Goose. And this is because the story starts about a year ago when Omar receives the letter from Rotary International. Rotary International is upset, to say the least, that the Golden Goose has been given to some person called Liz Hinkey. And what is East Chapel Hill Rotary doing, giving the famous Golden Goose to a nobody and, to boot, a Welsh woman? Well, Omar is Omar, co-founder of the Green Team. You can all guess what he did with that letter. He put it in the paper recycling. So fast forward to President Mike. And just before Christmas, Mike receives the letter, again, from the Vatican, from Rotary International, saying, again, very upset that East Chapel Hill Rotary is on the brink of excommunication if he does not go immediately in person to one Rotary Center in Everson, Illinois. Well, Mike, as the delegator in chief, says, I can't possibly go. I'm having my toenails clipped that day. You have to go. And I know you're not supposed to say no as a Rotarian, but I try, and Mike is adamant. You are the problem. You have to go. You have to fix this problem. Well, the next slide maybe wasn't the best slide that I should show. It's not exactly politically correct. But when I get to one Rotary Center, I am ecstatic to find the Welsh flag. Now, you may not know, but our current Rotary president is Gordon McInally, and he's a Scot. And I thought, I've got this, two Celts, we can work this out. So I go to see Gordon McInally. And I try. I do all my wiles. But as you can see, he is totally unmoved. So next, I go to see Stephanie Urchick, who's the president of Rotary-elect. And you can see from her face, she is not happy. East Chapel Hill is this close to excommunication from the Rotary family. And to explain myself. And so I start into how wonderful Peggy is. And she stops me and she says, who is this Peggy person? And I say, well, Dr. Jelaine Duhamel is, and before I can say another word, Stephanie Urchick stops me again and she says, do you mean the Peggy Duhamel? The Peggy Duhamel, who's the veterinarian, who can speak three languages, who's done vaccinations in India, who shepherds immigrants in this country and makes them feel welcome and connected. The Peggy Duhamel, who does international projects with, she's on the committee of, is it Two Mules, Peggy, that supports various aspects of life in Haiti. You mean Peggy, the Rotarian that we all strive to be? And then in a twinkle of an eye, this club is no longer at risk of excommunication, thanks to our very own Peggy. Hey.
I don't know how I'm going to beat that next year.
You're going to have to practice up. Oh, that's so cute.
Thank you, Liz, for an entertaining presentation. You can't get that anywhere else. That's why you're a member of East Chapel Hill Rotary. Only can you get that here. Now, without any more ado, to do, or whatever to do, I'm going to bring up Jennifer today to introduce our speaker. Jennifer.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, President Mike. Well, as a good Tar Heel, I do not wear the color red very often, but I am wearing red today in honor of our speaker, Mike Walden, who spent 43 years with North Carolina State University. You can see the bio there. I learned that his CV is 50 pages long, so we spared you from all the details, but put all the highlights down for you, including the fact that he has won our state's top honor, the Order of the Longleaf Pine. And Mike is here today to share with us about the economic forecast for 2024 and why we might be looking at two different economies this year. So please welcome Mike Walden.
Pleasure to be here with you. This is, I think, one of the largest Rotary groups I've ever spoken to. Normally, the Rotary clubs I speak to around the state are maybe 20, 30 attendees, so congratulations on that. Woo! I have my watch here. I know I've been schooled in Rotary etiquette. You are very punctual. I always like to start with a little humor. You might think economists aren't funny. Well, we'll see. As you were told, I retired in 2021 after 43 years, and I do consulting, I do speaking, I do writing. But that's not always the way retirees go. I had a friend who retired from academia, and he decided to pursue his interest that he always had to put aside when he was working. And one of his lifelong goals had been to learn how to skydive. So he signs up for a course program. He learns all the safety techniques that go along with skydiving. He took some jumps where he's attached to another professional. So he's done that. And the day for his first solo jump comes up. His family's very excited. His wife, his children, grandchildren all go to the jump landing site where he's supposed to land. And they're gonna film his descent, film his landing. So he plane takes off, he goes up, he jumps, he successfully lands, except he's way off course. Something about the prevailing winds. All he can see is he's somewhere in eastern North Carolina, and all he can see is corn everywhere. So he's standing there, sort of collecting his thoughts, what's he gonna do, when he sees in the distance a speck. And the speck progressively gets bigger and bigger and bigger, comes toward him. And within a couple minutes, he's confronted with what looks like a farmer standing in front of him. So the first question the skydiver asks the farmer is, where am I? The farmer says, you're in my cornfield. The skydiver is annoyed by that answer, so he looks back at the farmer and says, I bet you're an economist. Farmer looks a little surprised, but then he says, well, I guess you could say I was an economist. I took courses at NC State in agricultural economics. In today's farming world, you need to know about futures markets and pricing and foreign competitors, etc. How did you know I was an economist? And the skydiver says, because you told me something that was absolutely true, but of no use to me whatsoever. I say that, I give you that joke in a couple, two reasons. One, just to liven things up a little bit. But two, to lower your expectations. So if you get anything useful out of my talk, then you'll go away happy. Three parts of my talk, where we've been, where we are, and where we're going in the economy. Let's go back to where we've been. I was thinking about this the other day. I do a biweekly column, and I wrote a column about how the labor market, my next column actually coming out next week, about how the labor market in North Carolina has changed since COVID. And we're now what, 4 years? 4 years ago? This February, I remember my wife and I were planning a trip. Actually, we had the tickets to New York. My wife's from New York, and we would always like to go up to New York City occasionally and see Broadway plays. And we had tickets to, it was a revitalization of Plaza Suite, Simon's Plaza Suite. Matthew Broderick and who's his wife?
Sarah Jessica Hart.
Yeah, they were the leads. We're very excited about that. And I can remember we went out to dinner for my birthday. This would have been in late January. And we went out with some friends, and one of them said, well, you think you're going to be able to go? This COVID thing looks like it's getting more serious. And I remember being, oh, very common. Oh, no problem. Oh, yeah, nothing's going to happen. Yeah, not giving you confidence in my forecast. But anyway, it's been four years. If you look back, obviously COVID hit us like a hammer we didn't expect coming. It was very interesting, the response. I mean, the initial response by many was denial, but then people in power decided, yes, this is serious. And we had, remember Governor Cooper, a lot of these actions were done at the state level. Governor Cooper, like most governors in the nation, initially ordered stay-at-home orders. If you could stay home and work, do that. And fortunately, I was still teaching then, could easily do that. We just switched. NC State had what we call distance learning program for a long time, and the students were used to it. And so we just switched everything to virtual, and went like smooth as a glove. Other businesses didn't have as good of experience. But then we had the shutdown orders, where pretty much the leisure hospitality industry was shut down. A lot of other industries were shut down. So we knew, we being economists, knew this was not going to be good for the economy. Unemployment went up to 14%. I don't know if you remember that. 14% unemployment nationally, as well as here in North Carolina. I think in the Chapel Hill, Durham area, it went up 12%, so you were a little better. In terms of the broad economy, what we call gross domestic product, which is just the value of what we produce, everything aggregated, farmers, retail, manufacturing, all in one number, that fell at an annual rate of 33%, which was unprecedented. You'd have to go back to the Great Depression in the 1930s to find anything similar. So we were clobbered. Two good consequences, I guess. One is the so-called COVID recession didn't last very long. Back here in North Carolina, we began reopening the economy in May. And then secondly, the federal government poured a lot of money into the economy under two administrations. It's not partisan. In fact, if you look at all of the COVID legislation that was passed by Congress over the span of 2 years, $6.5 trillion pumped into the economy. I'll mention one of the downsides of that in a moment. But we survived. Fortunately, most of us survived. I actually met someone yesterday whose wife died of COVID, and I think that's probably the first person I met that I learned someone that I was talking to, we had a relative who died of COVID, so I don't want to minimize that. Right now, so that's where we were. Where are we now? Right now, we're well back. In fact, if you look, if I brought slides, which I did not, I would have showed you this, but just visualize it. If you take the economic trends that were prevailing in 2019, for example, the trend in employment, which had been going up for a while, 2019, the economy was great, and we were continuing to grow. If you take the trends that were existing then, and things like production, and employment, we're pretty much where, and it just extended that trend, just ignored COVID, just extended the trend in 2024, we're pretty much at where we would have been. So COVID hit us back for a while, but we've come back. So indeed, if you look at total employment, wherever, here in the Chapel Hill, Durham area, or in North Carolina or in the nation, we are beyond total number of jobs that we had in 2020. Unemployment, 3.7%, nice low number. When I was in graduate school 50 years ago, we were taught that 5% was about the best you could do in terms of unemployment, and that was blown away several years ago. So 3.7% unemployment. One of the numbers that's been lagging, however, is labor force participation. That was a sort of obscure number that economists followed, most people didn't. That really became a famous number, or a well-watched number during the recovery from COVID when we had the labor shortages, because what labor force participation measures is the percentage of people who could be working, who are working or looking for work. And that took a nosedive, as you might expect, during COVID. It's not quite totally recovered. And if you look at the breakdown from labor force participation in terms of demographic groups, particularly age groups, it's my generation, or the generation I'm in, that's lagging. I'm 73, so if you look at 65 or over, or 55 or over, whichever is your choice, the labor force participation of that demographic is well down from what it was pre-COVID. Now, one of the implications of that, when I give talks, I'm often asked a question. Usually it's not in the public forum. Someone will grab my arm as I'm leaving and say, "Dr. Walden, I'm still having trouble finding workers. What do I do?" And one of the answers, or one of the considerations, is not to overlook that age group, 55 and over. Those folks are not working at the rate that they were, but they maybe could be coaxed back by special, maybe a job with lesser hours or something. I was in a meeting with an expert. He has a company. All his company does is work with businesses on employee issues. And obviously one of the big employee issues the last couple of years has been finding workers. And he said, when I was listening to him talk, he said one of the things he tells his clients is, don't overlook older workers. You may have to restructure a job. For example, maybe you've got a job 40 hours a week. Maybe someone over age 55 is interested, but they don't want to work 48 hours a week, so break it up into two jobs. So anyway, that's just one practical idea. Now, besides the labor force participation issue, which has gotten much better, what has been the big issue since we were back on our feet? Employment's not an issue. Unemployment rate is back where it was. What has been the big issue over the last couple of years? Inflation. Again, if you look pre-COVID, we were bouncing around. The inflation rate varies a little bit, but over, I would say, between the two decades prior to COVID, the annual inflation rate rarely varied between 1.5% and 3%. Meaning average prices are going up somewhere between 1.5% a year and 3% a year. Now, often we'll get asked, "Well, Walden, isn't it even a little inflation is bad? Isn't it? Why don't we strive to have prices going down?" That actually is not a good idea for several reasons. If you look at a chart of when prices went down in this country, they're always during bad times. The most recent being during the subprime recession of 2008 to 2010. Yeah, prices went down, but we had a bad recession, the so-called Great Recession. So, you know, inflation rate between 1.5% and 3% is very good, very modest, and it's actually low enough that most people, not all, but most people see their wages or their hourly earnings go up to exceed that. So we did start to see inflation begin to bubble up at the end of 2020, then it really got going in 2021 and 2022. Year over year, we reached a peak inflation rate of 7.1% in mid-2022. So what that means from mid-2021 to mid-2022, average prices went up by 7.1%. Now, inflation has moderated. The latest reading, which we had last week, which looked at inflation, usually we look at inflation, measure inflation year over year. So what were prices a year ago, what are they now, and we calculate the percentage change. Last week we got the January 2024 inflation rate, which looks at price changes from January 23 to January 24, 3.1%. So we're moving in the right direction. Now, if you look at polls of people in the country, the polls show that people are not still happy with inflation. You would think that inflation was much worse 2 years ago, 7.1%, now 3.1%, and it has been headed down. You would think maybe people should be a little excited about that, but the polls show people are still very, very upset with inflation. Why is that? Well, I think there are two reasons. One has to do with what they hear, what people hear. And what do you hear in news reports when the news reporter talks about inflation and if inflation's gotten better? What the news reporter will actually say is inflation's down. That's not accurate. Inflation means prices are rising. Prices are still rising. It's the inflation rate that's down, the rate of increase. But when people hear inflation's down, what do they think? Prices should be down. So when they go in the grocery store or anywhere and they see the price is not down, they get upset. They get upset. So one correction is people in the media, especially, should watch their phraseology and report accurately that what they're talking about is the inflation rate, the rate of increase. That's what's lower. It's not that prices in general are lower. Some are, of course, but on average, prices are not down. So that's one issue. Second issue is that if you look since 2020, January 2021, just use that as your benchmark, yes, we've had price increases. Yes, they've moderated, but still wage rates have not gone up, have not risen enough to keep pace. So whenever a monetary number is adjusted for price increases, so you're looking at the purchasing power of your money, economists call that the real number. And in this case, the real wage rate, that is still down from where it was in 2021. Now, does this mean that people are keeping notes of all this? No, people aren't doing that, but they just have a sense. They have a sense that with what they're earning now, they still can't buy what they could buy in even in 2020, and certainly not in 2020 and 2019. So those are, I think, the two issues that the information about inflation is lacking on. A little background real quick on what sparked this big bout of inflation, because inflation had been a dead issue since the early 80s. I can remember my wife Mary and I were looking, we arrived here in 1978. We were looking for, we rented for a couple of years so that we could have a down payment on a house. It was either 1980 or 1981, I forget which year, but we were ready to go look at houses. We had enough for down payment. And we found a couple of houses, and then, of course, we needed financing. The mortgage rate, now, I may not get it exactly right, but the average mortgage rate on a 30-year fixed mortgage rate in the early 80s was something like 17%.
Yep.
Something like 17%. In fact, I go to the YMCA in the morning to exercise, and I see a lot of young people there, and they find out what I did for a living, so they'll often come to me for financial advice, which I'm happy to talk to them about. And I had a young friend, this was last year sometime, he was an entrepreneur, started a business, and his business was up and running, and he was so excited, he told me, I'm ready to go buy a house. And I said, well, great for you. He came back the next day and he said, I got some information on it, I got to borrow money on mortgages. They're like, I forget what it was a year ago, but 7-8%, he said, let's say it was 8%. It's an 8% mortgage rate. Boy, has it ever been that high? He said, this is crazy. And I said, well, actually, I don't want to burst your bubble, but yeah, 40 years ago, add another 10 to that. That was 17 or 18%. And he looked at me and said, come on, stop teasing me. Come on, be serious. And I said, well, go look it up. Anyway, what caused it almost appeared overnight, if you think about it. What caused prices to really jump? Because we had inflation, as I said, had been pretty much a dead issue for four decades. And if you go back to the recession previous to the COVID recession, that is the so-called, what I think I alluded to, the subprime recession, 2008-2010, we came out of that, inflation didn't budge. Inflation didn't budge. The biggest problem with that post-recession period was unemployment. It took a long time to come down. We were 10% or above unemployment for, I think, 3 years after that recession officially ended. So what caused it to be different this time? Well, I think it's clear, if you have some economics training, clear what happened. Everything in economics, everything, comes down to two factors, supply and demand. Supply and demand. I would tell my students when I gave them a test, and I would always give written tests. This would be on the in the intro to econ course, which I taught a lot of, and I'd give them a test, and then you have to write actual answers down, not multiple choice. And I would always tell them, and I wasn't trying to be flippant, I'd say, now if you get to a question and you just have no clue, you just blank out. I would tell them, I went through that many times, just blank out. Don't leave it blank. Write down supply and demand. I will probably give you partial credit. Some of them didn't even remember to do that. So what happened was two things. One, I mentioned we had $6.5 trillion of new federal money that was pumped into the economy, most of that going to households, stimulus plans, stimulus checks, expanded food stamps, expanded Obamacare, expanded child tax credits, etc. Most of that went into households. But they didn't have anywhere to spend it initially. So if you look at the data, what happened in late 2020 and into early 2021, the personal savings rate skyrocketed because people didn't have anything to spend that money on, but they were banking it. Then when they got to spend, started to spend, which would have been started to open late 2020 and then really opened wide in terms of spending availability or possibilities 2021, what did we have on the supply side? The supply chain issues, which no one forecasted. No one forecasted. So you had a classic example of too much money chasing too few goods and services. In our system, where prices are free to fluctuate, which incidentally I think is the proper system, prices would go up. So that's what really generated the inflation rate. The Federal Reserve, which I'm gonna get to in a moment, totally missed that. Most economists missed that, didn't forecast the spurt that we were going to have in inflation. Because we hadn't had that anything like that in recent recovery from recessions. So this then brings in the Federal Reserve. So I need to talk a little bit about the Federal Reserve. The Federal Reserve is an institution, it's actually a relatively new institution. It's been around a little over 100 years. It started because the United States, up until the early 20th century, when the Fed was instituted, United States didn't have any public backup system for private banks. All the other major countries in the world did. We did not. We were suspicious. We were a different country then. We were geographically divided, and the western part of the country, and even the Midwest, distrusted the big money people on the East Coast. They were worried that if we had some sort of a central bank, the East Coast people would capture it and use it to the negative of the rest of the people. So we had an incident though in the early 20th century. Some of you who read history or maybe have a history background remember this. It was either the first or second Teddy Roosevelt administration. Can't remember which. One of the big banks, I think it was called the Knickerbocker Bank in New York City, had a problem. And wind got out, so people think, oh, I got money in that bank, they got a problem, I'm gonna pull my money out. And once your neighbor's pulling their money out, and your other neighbor's pulling their money, you go pull your money out. So there was a run on the Knickerbocker Bank, and then that spread to other banks, even that weren't having problems. So there was a bank, there was a panic. And we had had these before, but not to this degree. Federal government had no tools. So President Roosevelt, the President of the United States, goes literally hat in hand to the richest man in the world, J.P. Morgan, and says, Mr. Morgan, can you help us out? Can you be a good patriot and help out the country? Can you and some of your colleagues, other rich people, get together and supply some money to these banks so people will have their faith in banks restored? We can't do it. Federal government, we don't have a means of doing that. J.P. Morgan did. He did. But the lesson there was the country, and particularly people in Congress, were probably shocked now that, hey, we can't have this again. We can't rely on going to rich people to bail out the country. So the Federal Reserve was established in 1913. And initially, the Federal Reserve's goal was to back up banks when they got in trouble. And we saw an example of that, was it last year or 2 years ago, Silicon Bank in California had a problem. Federal Reserve stepped in and there was no bank account. So we hummed along there, but then came the Great Depression and then World War II. And when World War II was over, a lot of people thought, we're just gonna go back to another depression. And so there were enough people in Congress who worried about that, and they thought about what other kind of institutional changes do we need to prevent a Great Depression? And they thought, I know, we know, we need to give the Federal Reserve another mandate, not just to back up troubled banks, but a need to back up the economy. When the economy is down and the unemployment rate is sky high, we need to have the Federal Reserve use their tools to cause economic growth. And then at the other hand, if we have a booming economy like we have here, but the problem is inflation, we need the Federal Reserve to use the tools also. And that, in essence, what the government was telling the Federal Reserve, and the Congress has the power of the Federal Reserve because they write their charter, what the Congress was telling the Federal Reserve, we want you to create the Goldilocks economy. Low unemployment and low inflation. Not one or the other, but have both. And the Federal Reserve has had that mandate ever since. Now, we have seen the Federal Reserve use that mandate very clearly in the last, both sides of that mandate, if you will, ever since 2020. As 2020 comes on, COVID hits, federal government starts pumping money into the economy. Behind the scenes, some of those people don't know this, behind the scenes, what was the Federal Reserve doing? They lowered their key interest rate to zero. That's why you had mortgage rates in 2020 and 2021 at what? Under 30-year fixed, under 3%. Unheard of. And also, the Federal Reserve was printing money and pumping it into the economy. In fact, two-thirds of that $6.5 trillion of funds that the federal government, under two administrations, allocated for COVID, that was all raised by borrowing. Who bought two-thirds of the federal treasury securities? It was the Federal Reserve. So the Federal Reserve was key behind the efforts to, many people think, rescue the economy from COVID in 2020. Now, or actually beginning in the Federal Reserve, as I said, was late to the game. It wasn't until 2022 that they realized, hey, we've got a problem here with inflation. We don't have a problem with unemployment, we got a problem with inflation. And the Federal Reserve jumped into action, and what they have been doing over the last 2 years is the opposite of what they did in fighting the COVID recession. They have been raising interest rates and pulling money out of the economy. And so they raised their federal funds rate, which is their key rate. They got it down to zero. They've raised it now, it's been at 5.25%. And they pulled out about $2 trillion of cash from the economy over the last couple of years. And what this is designed to do is to not kill economic growth, but slow it down. Slow it down. The Fed still wants people to spend, but they want them to spend at a slower pace. They still want businesses to create jobs, but at a slower pace. And if so, they're working on the demand side, and if they're slowing demand, then that will take the pressure off of prices. And they have been successful. Again, 7.1% peak in the middle of 2022. We're down to 3.1 right now. What the Federal Reserve is trying to do is achieve what's known in the business, and you'll be surprised that this is actually an economics term, a soft landing. Probably a lot of you have heard that, the term soft landing. What does that mean? Well, it's an analogy, and the analogy is, think of the economy as a plane. The higher the plane is, the higher the altitude of the plane, the higher the inflation rate. If the plane is able to be brought down to the runway without crashing, that means we get the inflation rate lower without crashing the economy into a recession. If the plane crashes, we get inflation lower, but we have a recession. And obviously what the Federal Reserve wants, and pretty much all of us want, is a soft landing. And it looks like the Fed may pull this off. Most economists, including yours truly, early last year thought we would have some kind of a recession in 2023. We did not. So the Federal Reserve has actually been very, very dedicated to their goal, and they've been pulling it off, I think, with a great deal of security. And although this may not be a big deal to you, if you look at, if you go back to the end of World War II up until the current time, there have been 13 periods of where the economy has gotten into a situation where the inflation rate is higher than desired, where the Federal Reserve steps in and tries to slow the economy down, bring that inflation rate down. There have been 13 examples of that. Of the 13, only one has had a soft landing. Only one. So if we have another soft landing this time, that will truly be we're in somewhat unique territory. I'm going to anticipate a question when I stop for questions. Some people want to know what was the one time, not counting this one. It's 1995, early 1995. Those of you in finance may remember this. Alan Greenspan, chair, Federal Reserve. In my opinion, Walden's humble opinion, he's the greatest Federal Reserve chair we've ever had. He's one of the great economic minds of the 21st century. I think Greenspan's ability was his uncanny ability to look at numbers. He was a numbers guy. He had a bad back. He would soak in his tub, for 2 hours every morning. Not to waste that time, he would have his aides bring the latest numbers in. He sat in his tub and looked at all the numbers. He had an uncanny ability to look at numbers and put them together to draw a picture of what was happening and would happen. Just uncanny mind. Anyway, in early 95, he looked at the numbers and he decided we're headed for a big rise in inflation, the inflation rate, I should say. We need to head this off in the past. Federal Reserve Chair is not a dictator. The Federal Reserve Chair has to get the majority of the board members, of which there are 10, I believe. So he was able to convince them, and the rest is history. So now let me go to my final category, and that is where we're going. As I said, 2023 turned out to be a positive year for the economy. We grew, job growth, we created jobs, unemployment rate stayed low, the inflation rate seems to be moderating, and no recession. Can't ask for a better economy than that. 2024, well, first thing I'm gonna say is I don't think we're gonna have a recession in 2024, although, given our track record, economist track record in 2023, you might wanna think the opposite, but anyway. A little bit of gallows humor, I guess. The key question for 2024 is, when's the Federal Reserve going to start lowering interest rates? That's the key. The Fed has already signaled they are going to lower, but they have not told us when they were going to be lower, which is not unusual. The Federal Reserve likes to play it close to the vest. I'll give you another Greenspan story. If you read Greenspan's autobiography, he talks about in there about how he thought Federal Reserve policy should not be communicated. I mean, the President, the Congress, they communicate what they want to do with policy. Federal Reserve doesn't. They're very abstract. And Greenspan really perfected this. Federal Reserve chairs are called up to Congress to testify to various committees several times a year. And Greenspan did that. And Greenspan had an ability, and some of you may want to call up, you can probably find it online, some of his testimony. He would go up to Congress, Congressional Committee, Senate Committee. He would take questions. He did two things. He would compliment the senator or representative who asked the question. He would always say, Senator, Representative, that's one of the best questions I've ever gotten. You are so insightful. Let me try to answer. So he butter up his questioner. But number two, he would talk, and he had beautiful sentence structure, threw in a lot of important sounding words, but if you looked at the transcript, he said absolutely nothing. That got to be called Greenspan speak. If you're able to do that, you're using Greenspan speak. And when he retired and wrote his autobiography, he's clear about that. Now, his notion was Federal Reserve should not communicate what they're going to do. The viewpoint being that markets will react, and if they don't do it, it could be. We don't know when the Federal Reserve is going to lower. What we do think is going to happen, the Federal Reserve will lower, and they'll probably lower more their key rate several times. There's a debate among economists when. I'm in the camp that I don't think they're going to start lowering lowering their rate until mid-year. I'm going to target May. They meet every 6 weeks. So I'm targeting May as their first cut. And there are other economists. I was on a panel a couple months ago with a good friend of mine who's an economist, UNC Charlotte. He thinks the opposite. He thinks they're going to cut. We've already gone past one. He's already been wrong for one meeting because they didn't cut it their last meeting. Anyway, so I think they're going to start cutting at the mid-year. They're at five and a quarter. I think they'll do this in several stages. I think they'll cut down to somewhere between, this is their rate now, 3.5 and 4. Again, they're at 5.25. So what is that, percentage and a half, something like that. And you could sort of shave a similar number off mortgage rates and say, okay, at the end of the year mortgage rates, what are they, 7, a little over 7 now, so they'll be 5.5. And then they'll continue in 20 and 2095. I think the question part of the year is the first part of the year. If they're not cutting, and this gets a little bit in the weeds, and I'm sorry to complicate things, but if the Federal Reserve keeps their interest rate constant and other interest rates are constant, yet the inflation rate is moderating, that means what economists call the real interest rate is going up. And that's really what affects borrowers. So I think that the first half of the year, it's going to be bumpy. We're not going to fall into a cavern of a recession, but I think there's going to be some potholes along the way. We've already seen, for example, the January consumer spending came out last week. It was actually down. Consumer spending was down. And my concern is that consumers have run through, they've already depleted that COVID savings. And now they're starting to borrow more. They've been borrowing. And we're seeing delinquencies go up. We're seeing interest payments as a percent of income go up, and there's a limit to that. So I think we're going to be a little bumpy in the first half of the year. You may see a couple months where the unemployment rate goes up, not anything dramatic. You may see situations where we have announcements of more of some layoffs, et cetera, but nothing that's going to bring it to the level of a recession. I couldn't see the unemployment rate go up higher if this is national than 5%, or what, at 3.7 now. So I think first half will be a little bumpy, second half will be much better. Everything we lost maybe in the first half, we will recover in the second half. The other thing I might mention, and I don't get into politics, but I think this is worthy of mention. The Federal Reserve will probably be the focus of some criticism from some of the major candidates in 2024. This is not unprecedented. If the Federal Reserve is, candidates will say, they'll be arguing on both sides. If the Federal Reserve cuts interest rates, the candidate for whom, usually the incumbent, will be saying, that's good, that's helping me. The opponent will say, Fed is plain politics. And we've seen, for example, President Carter, when he was running for re-election in 1980, highly critical of the Federal Reserve. Very bluntly critical of the Federal Reserve. And then just to be nonpartisan, in 1992, President George H.W. Bush, same way, his was a little more nuanced. He wasn't complaining the Federal Reserve wasn't cutting. He was complaining they weren't cutting enough. So get ready for that, and that will be a sidebar. All right, last thing before I stop and take whatever number of questions you want to throw at me until you leave. What about this here? What about, I'm gonna talk broadly about the triangle. Oftentimes I'll have people ask, well, we're in the triangle. We are, if not the first, the best growing economy in the country, we're up there in the single digits somewhere. Maybe it's Austin, maybe it's us. Aren't we, if there's a national recession or even a national bumpiness, potholes, will we have any potholes? Well, we won't have any potholes, right? Because we're growing so fast. No, that's not the case. If you look at the data, go back as many recessions as you want. Yes, the metrics indicating recession are less severe here, but they're still there. You can still see job loss. You can see still see unemployment rate go up, et cetera. So everything I've said about maybe the bumpy economy in the first half of the year, be wary of that and just be cautious. One other thing, sort of like Columbo. I'm sort of like Columbo. One more thing before I stop. And this is a long run forecast. It's not going to shake you. It's not anything dramatic or anything you've not heard about. But I've actually been saying this for years. I do think one of the biggest issues in the country, but certainly here in North Carolina and the Triangle, is going to be changes in skill demands in the labor market. The labor market, and now with AI, it's just even more important. The labor market is changing dramatically. What businesses need labor for is going to be different than what businesses need labor for even a decade ago. And we need to have our universities and community colleges and even high schools be ready for that and respond and be ready for, I can see a whole need for retraining. So I think that's going to be maybe the issue of the decade. Yes?
Professor Walden, would you comment on labor force needs and one of the hottest issues right now, immigration?
Well, you look at it, I mean, interesting. The immigrants bring skills. Immigrants bring labor. And the Congressional Budget Office, there's a lot of question about why did the economy grow so well in 2023 when a lot of economists think it wouldn't. And I told you one of my ideas was that it's because there was a COVID savings that people was brought down. Congressional Budget Office just issued a report last week, it was interesting to bring this question, that said the level of immigration has also been affected. We've had so many immigrants come in that they've actually provided a boost to the economy. I'm not getting into security or anything like that, but clearly immigrants, if we have a labor supply that's growing slowly, which it is, and it's expected to grow slowly, immigrants obviously help provide some skills. Now, I think just like domestic workers who've been here a long time, I still think the changing skills that will affect immigrants as well as others. Yes. Nice jacket. Yes, sir.
Thank you. If, with everything you've talked about, if we had tied the minimum wage to inflation when we did so for my Social Security, it'd now be well over $27 an hour, $56,000 a year. We have started, I hear presentations all the time about people with good starting jobs that pay less than $50,000. We have teachers starting in the low 40s. Wouldn't things be very, very different than almost everything you talked about if we made the minimum wage keep up with inflation, catch up with my Social Security?
Yes, and that's an old proposal that would make automatic increases. I mean, that goes to my notion that if you look at economic numbers and you look at change, you always need to factor in inflation. So you're absolutely right. The real minimum wage has gone down substantially over the last 10 or 20 years. So, yeah, that's a problem.
One more.
You pick. That's
my kid. You pick. We're going to have a new member.
Who's a Cincinnati Reds fan? Who's a Cincinnati Reds
fan? I have a baseball with the 75 Reds. I have three boys in college, and they've watched their rent go up 40% since COVID. They've watched their food costs go up 40%. Two of them are now graduating, and they found them Phi Beta Kappa with honors, one's Bob Med Engineer, and they found the job market for college grads very tight. Mm-hmm. And even though inflation is not, the rate's not as high, it's still more expensive to live, mm-hmm. and the housing rates mm-hmm. are rent, there's no way you're gonna buy a house, and rent is still very high. Mm-hmm. Is the job market tight because we're anticipating this bumpy road, or is it just my boys and his friends? Nobody wants them. They don't like them. And it's interesting, they have friends who did not go to college, they're doing quite well. It's electricians, construction, or builders.
I think there, and I don't want to promote myself as an expert on this, this is actually something I want to look into more. But I have read several research pieces that suggest that how employers are viewing college degrees, how they're doing them in a different way. And college degree doesn't give you the standout step that it used to. And that a lot of employers have gone, no, I shouldn't say a lot, but some employers have gone to community college degrees, and then if the worker needs further skills, on the job training. So I think that's, there's been a shift there. Yeah.
Okay. Thanks, everybody. I'll see everybody back here next week. Have a great weekend. Stay safe out there.